people assume that experiments in science are usually very expensive and are very resource intensive. However, this is not always true. Not all experiments require many resources. So let's talk about the work of Alfred Hershey and Martha Chase, for example. Did you know that the Hershey and the Chase experiment was one of the most remarkable works in the field of genetics? What was the experiment about? And what does it help us infer? Let's find that out. In the timeline of the history of genetics that we looked at, we have reached this point. So let's step ahead and jump to the year 1952. Two American geneticists, Alfred Hershey and Martha Chase, carried out a very simple experiment that helped figure out whether DNA was really the transforming principle or not. The experiment was quite simple. It just required a culture medium, two different radioactive isotopes, a mixer blender, and a centrifuge tube. A culture medium is a medium used to grow different kinds of microorganisms. With this equipment, they carried out an experiment using a bacteriophage and a bacterial strain. Let's find out how the experiment was framed. Before that, can you tell me what bacteriophage is? The term phage means virus. So the name bacteriophage stands for virus that infects bacteria. So bacteriophages usually infect the host bacterium by inserting their genetic material into them. And they make copies of themselves using the replication machinery of the host bacterium. The interesting thing here is that the body of any bacteriophage is simply made up of two components, the outer protein coat and the inner genetic material. Now, let's get back to the Hershey and Chase experiment. The main aim of their experiment was to find out what exactly is the genetic material. Is it proteins or DNA? Since the phage contains only proteins and DNA, it's easier to find out which component gets into the host bacterium. They simply used radio-labeled markers to identify the different strains. So if the bacterial cells have the radioactively marked proteins in the end, then it's the proteins which are the genetic material. On the other hand, if the radio-labeled DNA makes its way into the bacterial cell, then probably the DNA is the genetic material. So the experiment was quite simple. They first obtained radio-labeled bacteriophages. One strain had the radio-labeled proteins and the other had radio-labeled DNA. Then they allowed these different bacteriophages to separately infect the bacteria. And at the end, they analyzed the bacteria to find out which radio-labeled component had made its way into it. But how did they obtain the radio-labeled proteins and DNA? What was the process they used? And how were the results analyzed at the end? Let's find that out in the next part. Hershey and Chase used bacteriophages, which are the viruses that infect the bacteria. We know that their bodies are made up of only proteins and DNA. That makes it easier to figure out what gets into the host bacterial cells. The experiment was quite simple. They first obtained radio-labeled bacteriophages. There were two different types. Ones with radio-labeled proteins and the others with radio-labeled DNA. Then they allowed these different bacteriophages to separately infect the bacteria. And at the end, they analyzed the bacteria as to which radio-labeled component had made its way into it. This is how the simple experiment helped answer a few important queries. Now let's get into the details of this experiment and understand it step by step. The first thing Hershey and Chase did was that they obtained the radio-labeled phage strains. In one nutrient medium, they added the radioisotope sulfur-35, which is S-35. In the other, they added phosphorus-32, which is P-32. But why only sulfur and phosphorus? And that too in separate mediums? Well, sulfur is an integral part of proteins, but it's not present in the DNA. On the other hand, phosphorus is present in the DNA, but not in the proteins. Thus, for easy analysis, they chose the radioisotopes of these two elements. So one nutrient medium was added with the sulfur-35 radioisotope. The bacteria grown in this medium does had S35 incorporated into their bodies. Now, what will happen if the bacteriophages are allowed to infect these bacteria? It's obvious that S35 will get incorporated in the protein coats of these bacteriophages as well. That is because these are derived from the body of these host bacteria. So their first batch of S35 labeled bacteriophages was ready. Similarly, in this culture medium, they added P32 and allowed the growth of bacterial colonies. As a result, all the bacteriophages obtained post-infection had radio-labeled DNA. So the second batch of bacteriophages with radio-labeled DNA was also ready with them. Now, all they had to do is allow these radioactively marked bacteriophages to infect new bacterial cells. These host cells will be the ones harboring the new phage generations, which will help analyze what has passed down the line. So they infected the bacterial cells with the two batches separately. After several hours of infection, the cultures were agitated in a mixer blender. Why is this step necessary? It is needed to make sure that post-infection, the empty phage coats get separated from the bacterial cells. The agitation helps release the empty phage coats attached to the bacterial cells. Now in the next step, they centrifuged the culture at an extremely high speed. Centrifugation process works on the principle of gravitational force. So when the sample is centrifuged at a very high speed, the heavier, denser particles settle at the bottom, while the lighter particles remain on top. What is settled at the bottom is usually called pellet, while the one that floats on top is called supernatant. So the centrifugation step helped Hershey and Chase to obtain two layers. The one on top was supernatant and the one at the bottom was pellet. They checked the radioactivity in both the batches and concluded their analysis. Before we reach the conclusions, can you help Nora guess the interpretation? What will be the interpretation if the radioactivity is found in the supernatant? And what will be the inference if it's found in the pellet? Think about it. Let me help you with this. The supernatant contains phage ghosts, which are the empty shells or coats of phage. It does not have the replicated next generations of the bacteriophages. Similarly, the pellet will contain the bacterial cells and the newer phage particles. So now, in case one, if the radioactivity is observed in the supernatant, then it means that the marker is only present in the protein coat of the phage and did not get into the bacterial cells. This can help us conclude that the proteins are not the genetic material, as the newly formed phage particles did not receive S35. On the other hand, if the radioactivity is seen in the pellet, then it would mean that the newer phage cells have all got the radioactive P32 in them. Thus, the DNA in the form of genetic material has successfully got transformed into the new phage particles. This is what the analysis of both the cases can be. Now let's look at the results Hershey and Chase obtained. On analyzing the first sample, they found that the radioactivity was present in the supernatant. And in the second batch, the radioactivity was found in the pellet. What did this mean? That's right. With this, the two concluded that it's the DNA which is the genetic material and not the proteins. If proteins would have been the genetic material, then the pellet in the first batch would have shown the presence of radioactive S35. Instead, the pellet in the second batch showed the presence of P32. Thus, it was confirmed that it's the DNA which is the genetic material. With this, Avery, McLeod and McCarty's analysis that Griffith's transforming principle was DNA was also proved. Thus, the long-ignored DNA molecule now rose to fame, and scientists all over the globe started working on finding its structure. But how was the structure discovered? And what does the actual structure of a DNA molecule look like? Let's find that out in the next part.